Shall be your guide to the tale of one Harry Potter. An ordinary name, to be sure. His legend, however, is anything but. And over the course of the next 8 or so weeks, we shall be charting the progress of this magnificent mage. But for now, I feel there is someone else who wishes to join this conversation. Accio!
Where, who, what? Funky? What's with the robe?
Oh, Mr. Edward, you haven't forgotten, have you? We're reviewing Harry Potter.
Oh, yes, of course, right. Carry on.
Now, let us begin at the beginning, seeing that it is a very good place to begin, with Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone, or the Sorcerer's Stone in the US. Don't ask me why, I don't know. Anyway, as is customary, I will let our guest fill us in on the details.
Thank you, sir. It all started when Joanne Rowling thought of this nice idea on a train in 1990.
Mr. Edward, much as I would like to discuss the books at length, we are primarily concerned with the movies today.
Okay, very well then.
Released in November of 2001, The Philosopher's Stone is, as previously mentioned, the first chapter of this saga, introducing us to our principal characters and the world they live in. Adventure lurks around every corner for a seemingly ordinary boy, whose true destiny may hold the secret to ending the threat of the Dark Lord once and for all.
So grab your wand, step onto platform 9¾, and hope you don't get a vomit-flavored jelly bean, as we commence the Potterthon with Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. Meet Harry Potter. He's not exactly your average kid, and this is his remaining family, the dreadful Dursleys. But let's not concern ourselves with them. Because all it takes is one letter to change this beaten-down, bespectacled boy's life forever. Despite the Dursleys' best efforts.
Someone's going to an awful lot of trouble to contact this kid. Hope he's worth it.
But even in the windswept nothingness far from Surrey, there is no escape from destiny.
You're a wizard, Harry.
And so the prepubescent Potter lad begins his journey, acquiring all the various things he needs from London's famous magic district, Diagon Alley. The conversation turns towards darker things.
Not all wizards are good. A few years ago, there was one wizard that went as bad as you can go, and his name was Voldemort. But nobody lived once he decided to kill him. Except you.
Yes, my friends. Harry Potter is the only known survivor of a very deadly sort of spell. But we'll learn more about that spell, and its brethren, when we drink from the Goblet of Fire.
And so young Harry boards the train to Hogwarts, where he meets our other protagonists, Ron Weasley and Hermione Granger.
Has anyone seen a toad? Oculus, Reparo.
Never mind Specsavers, should have gone to Hogwarts.
After the train, a boat, and then our would-be wizards and witches are sorted into their houses.
So that's the famous English school system, eh?
Steady! And so school begins! Have it your way, then. A lesson in flying leads Professor McGonagall to enroll Harry in the Quidditch team.
I have found you a seeker.
Harry receives a bluffer's guide to the noble sport of Quidditch.
And so Halloween rolls around.
In the danger!
But an unkind comment from Ron leaves Hermione in danger. Luckily, our boys venture where no man has gone before and overcome what no man could defeat alone.
Very impressive.
But now, Quidditch.
Gryffindor starts strongly. And the Seeker seeks. But then, foul play enters the game. But one spectator puts paid to the cheating.
You're on fire!
Look away now if you don't want to know the score.
It's got
the... The plot really kicks off after a fortuitous gift leads our miniature mage in search of information about Nicholas Flamel. What he finds instead is Snape confronting Quirrell.
I don't want me as your enemy, Quirrell.
And a very special mirror.
I see that you, like so many before you, have discovered the delights of the Mirror of Erised.
Tomorrow, it will be moved to a new home.
Come January, Hermione discovers Flamel's biography.
Yes. Nicholas Flamel is the only known maker of the Philosopher's Stone.
And the trio discuss their findings with Hagrid.
Why?
Snape is one of the teachers protecting the stone. He's not about to steal it.
Allow me. But oh dear.
Oh dear indeed, because Malfoy was spying on them and rats them out. And so our heroes, and distinctly secondary villain, serve in the Dark Forester's punishment. And just look what they find! Who was that shadowy figure? And what do you suppose he's after? I know, but I ain't telling.
And so the stage is set for our finale. After Professor McGonagall brushes off their fears, the trio make their way towards the stone themselves. But first, they have to get past Neville Longbottom.
Petrificus Totalus.
Oh, right. Moving on.
Our heroes encounter a series of tests to reach the stone. From a three-headed dog, to a deceptive deadly root, to winged keys, and even a giant game of wizard's chess. But eventually, Harry makes his way to the chamber.
But rather than Snape, Harry encounters Professor Quirrell. Further to this, he discovers Quirrell's dark secret. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me to introduce you to our main villain for the next 8 or so weeks, the Dark Lord Voldemort. And when Quirrell attacks, our half-pint hero proves that he has the touch. But a ghostly Dark Lord won't be denied.
And when Harry awakes, Dumbledore informs him of his lover Flamel's decision.
Oh, wait a minute. Lover?
Ah, yes. Now, I wanted to get this out of the way. You see, according to J.K. Rowling, Albus Dumbledore is gay. Allow me to defer to the Legion's resident expert on gay culture to fill you in on the details.
I'm Rantasmo and cameo!
Quite. Anyway. I suppose that J.K. Rowling decided that being a great hero doesn't necessarily have to mean being straight. Quite progressive in a way. And so our movie ends with the end of term feast and a heartfelt goodbye on the platform to London. And so we close the book on the first chapter of Harry Potter and usher it gently unto the House of Love. This first film has a lot of setting up to do, and it fair takes its time doing it. But once it gets going, it's a great family film. You really get a sense of wonder from it, that Harry is taken from this almost hellish sub-existence into a world of magic and celebrity that would turn even a well-adjusted person into a bit of a big head.
Like with many book adaptations, I found it to be quite short. Details missing, moved around, changed, added, and even as a standalone film it has its misses. I found some of the details added to be good ones, others seemed to just be fillers. True that not everything in books and comics work on the silver screen, and so I believe this is a very good film in its own right. I especially liked the cast they chose, fitted my image of the characters well. Definitely recommended for those who can't read or don't have the patience for audiobooks.
And while I could argue that this film spends a little too long on the school aspects and a lot less time on the menace of Voldemort, that would be missing the point. Of course it's light and fluffy. These are the good times. The dark days are still to come. But be assured, they will come. But we'll get to that. For now though, allow me to take this opportunity to thank my co-host, Mr. Edward, for stopping by.
Well, thank you for having me.
And allow me to take this opportunity to thank you, my audience, for joining me upon this day. Let us reconvene 7 days hence, for to delve into the Chamber of Secrets. Spellcasting! D-I-S-M-I-S-S!